The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
And we made it to a Friday. Barely, but we made it. It looks like, for whatever reason, oh no, YouTube is not starting, and I don't know why. I'm having all kinds of tech problems, but what else is new? Oh my goodness, we just got back on YouTube, and it looks like it's not going to let us stream there today. So you may, just may, have to come over to Facebook. I honestly don't know if we're on Periscope or Twitch, because I'm trying something new, and it seems to to not be working. So I don't know. All I can say is come try to find us somewhere. It looks like nothing is going, except Facebook Live. So we are on Facebook today in terms of video. Everything else seems to be kind of foobar. I'll try to fix it, but I'll put a note in the YouTube chat room. But, you know, we're live at 5 to Pacific, so I'm at the mercy of the clock. Oh, best laid plans. You know, I had a stressful day today, in that I had a doctor's appointment earlier today. I had to go see the neurosurgeon to get an MRI on my brain because of what we believe is a meningioma. Long story, but yeah, hold on. Let me just type YouTube not work. I'm typing in the YouTube chat room. You know, it's times like this I could use a producer. Not working. Come to Facebook. Sorry. All right. So, anyway, I was kept waiting for an hour and a half, and I was ready to leave, and then the doctor came in, and it turned out I really liked her. So, you know, such is life. Today is also just a weird day. It's October 23rd. We are 11 days out from Election Day. Tensions are high. We made it through the last debate last night. We'll get into that in a moment. But it was 41 years ago today that my mother died, except she wasn't officially died until 41 years ago tomorrow, because she suffered. What happened is she had leukemia. Making a long story, very long story short, but she had leukemia, and what killed her apparently wasn't the leukemia. She had an aneurysm, and she went into the hospital, I guess, on the 22nd. I was in school, in away at college in Tampa, and I got a call from my dad who said, you know, you said, Mom's going to the hospital, everything's okay, don't worry. And then the next day she fell into a coma. They said she was brain dead. We had to wait 24 hours of where there was no brain activity before turning off the life support. It was horrible. And now, 41 years later, when October 23rd and 24th come around, you better believe I feel it. And I'm feeling it extra hard this year because there's so much death around us. There's so much it's just horrible. And now with COVID, you know, everywhere you go, I was out at this doctor's appointment this morning, and I'm waiting and waiting and waiting and getting more and more stressed as the hour and a half ticked by. And somebody came out of the exam room, an older man wearing a mask, but it was down, you know, around his mouth and chin. And I said, it really needs to cover your nose. I know. Well, if you know, then do it. I'm sorry. This is, it's no more, we can't screw around anymore. This is dangerous. People are dying. Now all these hospitals in the Midwest, in the West, in the as Donald Trump calls them, red states, are all catastrophic. The ICU units are filled to capacity, and it's, you know, I don't know why people are screwing around. And Donald Trump had another event at the White House today in the Oval Office with very few masks and no social distancing. Unbelievable. And yes, I watched the debate last night, and I have some observations and some highlights and lowlights to share with you. And our guest today, I'm keeping my fingers crossed because I see he still hasn't accepted my invitation on Skype yet, but he's supposed to join us at the bottom of the hour, he being Nicholas Kristof, who is a two-time Pulitzer Prize winning journalist who has a column in a twice a week column in the New York Times. And he and his wife last year wrote a book called Tightrope. Let me get the subtitle for you because it's a very important part of it. Tightrope, Americans Reaching for Hope. So they released the book last year. And on Monday, the film adaptation of it debuts on the World Channel, which I don't have, but also worldchannel.org and pbs.org. And it's a very personal but difficult film because it's about this disconnect in America. It's about poverty and hopelessness, thus Tightrope, Americans Reaching for Hope, and the income gap and the wealth gap and all the other inequities in our society. And I'll tell you, you know, it was not an easy film to watch, but it's something we should all watch. Because you notice during this campaign, candidates talk about, and this is not unique to this campaign, it's every presidential campaign. And I've noticed this for a number of cycles going back. They talk about the middle class. They never talk about the people living in poverty. And I believe, and I don't have facts to back it up, I don't have statistics, so I'm just saying I believe that those living in poverty make up the fastest growing segment of our population, sadly. And with the effects of this pandemic, it's only going to get worse. So we'll talk to Nick Kristof about all that. But I want to start today with a song that I found online this morning, and I know that I'm risking another copyright strike. I know, but I think this is worth it. I really do. And please, you know, the thing is, it's the Black Eyed Peas with Jennifer Hudson, a video produced by Will I Am, who's the guy who did the big, you know, the Obama song, 12 years ago, Yes We Can. Remember how powerful that was? Well, this is one of those. And the Black Eyed Peas, I tweeted it out this morning and said, oh my God, this is just brilliant. Everyone needs to watch this. And the Black Eyed Peas Twitter account liked the tweet. So I just tweeted back to them and said, I want to play this on my show today. I'm going to risk, I'm really quiet on Progressive Voices. Why would that be? Okay. All right, I'll try to turn it up a little bit and see if this helps. Anyway, so I tweeted back to them and I said, I want to play this on my show today. I'm afraid I'm going to get a copyright violation. Well, you have my back, and I haven't heard back from them yet, but I'm going to risk it anyway because I think they want this shared, and it's called The Love. And I believe, and I just show, I'm not really a Black Eyed Peas fan, but you'll see why this is so good. So I'm gonna risk it. Just keep your fingers crossed. All right, so let's do it. Black Eyed Peas with Jennifer Hudson. It's called The Love. Oh, and it features Joe Biden too. Here we go.
Good evening. Ella Baker, a giant of the civil rights movement, left us with this wisdom. Give people light, and they will find the way. Give people light. Those are words for our time. Just a week ago yesterday was the third anniversary of the events in Charlottesville. Close your eyes. Remember what you saw on television. Remember seeing those neo-Nazis. Remember seeing those Klansmen.
Remember
coming out of fields with lighted torches, veins bulging, spewing the same anti-Semitic bile heard across Europe in the 30s. Remember the violent clash that ensued between those spreading hate and those with the courage to stand against it. Remember what the president said when asked? He said there were, quote, very fine people on both sides. It was a wake-up call for us as a country. And for me, a call to action.
People killing, people dying, children hurt and you hear them crying. Can you practice what you preach? And would you turn the other cheek? Father, 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 help us. Send some guidance from above. These people got me questioning. Where is the love?
What's wrong with the world, mama? People living like they ain't got no mamas. I think the whole world's addicted to the drama. Only attracted to things that'll bring the trauma. Overseas, yeah, we trying to stop terrorism. But we still got terrorists here living. In the USA, the KKK. I can't believe they're still hating blacks today. Cause if you only have love for your own race, then you only leave space to discriminate. And to discriminate only generates hate. And when you hate, then you're bound to get irate. Yeah, madness is what you demonstrate. And that's exactly how hate works and operates. Man, you gotta have love to set it straight. Take control of your mind and meditate. Let your soul gravitate to the love.
People killing, people dying, children hurt and you hear them crying. Can you practice what you preach? And would you turn the other cheek? Father, 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 help us. Send some guidance from above. These people got me questioning. Where is the love? The love.
The question for us is simple. Are we ready? I believe we are. We must be. We can choose a path of becoming angrier, less hopeful, more divided, a path of shadow and suspicion, or we can choose a different path and together take this chance to heal, to reform, to unite, a path of hope and light. This is a life-changing election. This will determine what America is going to look like for a long, long time.
Yes, it is.
Character is on the ballot. Compassion is on the ballot. Decency, science, democracy.
Yeah.
They're all on the ballot. Who we are as a nation, what we stand for, and most importantly, who we want to be, that's all on the ballot. And the choice could not be more clear.
Wow. Talk about powerful. And what a day for me not to be streaming video anywhere except Facebook. I am recording the video, though, and I will post it after the show, but I'll probably put it on YouTube and they'll copyright violate me. But the video is every bit as powerful as the song with the lyrics and vice versa. Wow, oh wow, oh wow, Black Eyed Peas, Will I Am doing it again. Good stuff, huh? All right, I'm sorry about the tech problems today, but it is a radio show first and foremost. So what do you say? Should we get into some of the debate last night while we're waiting for Nicholas Kristof? Well, we did. We made it through the second and final presidential debate. I guess the silver lining, if you're looking for one, is that Donald Trump and Joe Biden debated for the last time last night. And I guess, well, it was better than the first one, although that's not saying a whole lot. Kristen Welker of NBC, I thought, did an admirable job as moderator by keeping things moving. She did what she could. When you're dealing with Donald Trump, your hands are tied as to how much you could do. So, and Trump was on slightly better behavior than at the last one, but that's a very low bar. And actually, he was on better behavior for the first third or so of the thing. And then he started to pull out this nonsense, his conspiracy theory about Hunter Biden and the laptop and China and Russia and bears, oh my, and oh my God, it just made no sense at all. But You know, so this was his big surprise last night. Donald Trump attempting to link Joe Biden to a conspiracy he's been pushing with Fox and other right-wing media outlets, and it fizzled. But as with the first debate, the second one was canceled. The 90 minutes was split into six topics, and the first was the pandemic. And Donald Trump continued in his usual "it's going away," despite rising cases around the country. In fact, true to form, the very first thing he said was a lie.
It's a real figure, but
oh, hold on. Where's I gotta find the actual oh shit. No, I can't find it. Where Donald Trump I can't find his original clip. But what he said was, we were told 2.2 million people would die, so we only have 220,000. That we're doing great. And so this is Daniel Dale fact-checking the first thing out of Donald Trump's mouth.
It's a real figure, but Trump falsely describes it, and he's continued to do this at his rallies.
Yeah.
Now, what this figure said, it was a report from British academics, and it said that in the U.S., if no U.S. government did anything to mitigate the virus, to fight the virus, and no citizen took social distancing action, then we could see 2 million plus deaths. But this was not an expectation. It was not a realistic estimate. This was a figure put out there to say, this is how bad it gets if you just let this virus run its course, which, of course, the government was not about to do.
The government was not about to do. By the way, he started off his fact checking segment last night by saying this.
President Trump was better behaved tonight, but he lied more. This was just a bombardment of dishonesty, much of which we've heard before.
Yeah, so, okay. Better behaved, but he lied more. So, Joe Biden, I thought, did a good job. Especially with the Trump people trying to paint him as demented, as, you know, suffering from Alzheimer's or something. I think Donald Trump needs to look in the mirror. Joe Biden did warn that winter is coming. All right. He didn't exactly invoke Game of Thrones, but
this is the same fellow who told you this is going to end by Easter last time. This is the same fellow who told you that, don't worry, we're going to end this by the summer. We're about to go into a dark winter. A dark winter. And he has no clear plan, and there's no prospect that there's going to be a vaccine available for the majority of the American people before the middle of next year.
Yep.
President Trump, your reaction? He says you have no plan.
I don't think we're going to have a dark winter at all.
No.
We're opening up our country. We've learned and studied and understand the disease, which we didn't at the beginning.
You know, this brings to mind that old saying, a denial is just a river and is not just a river in Egypt. I'm so bad at those old sayings. Anyway, Joe Biden, though, didn't let him off the hook.
220,000 Americans dead.
Yep.
If you hear nothing else I say tonight, hear this. Anyone who's responsible for not taking control, in fact, not saying I take no responsibility initially.
Yep.
Anyone who's responsible for that many deaths,
he said,
should
that
not remain as president of the United States of America. We're in a situation where there are 1,000 deaths a day now, 1,000 deaths a day, and there are over 70,000 new cases per day. Compared to what's going on in Europe, as the New England Medical Journal said, they're starting from a very low rate. We're starting from a very high rate. The expectation is we'll have another 200,000 Americans dead.
And that went up today.
Between now and the end of the year.
Yep.
If we just wore these masks, the president's own advisors have told him, we could save 100,000 lives. And we're in a circumstance where the president thus far and still has no plan, no comprehensive plan.
No comprehensive plan at all. And what does Trump say? He said, we're learning to live with it.
Your reaction?
I say over soon. I say we're learning to live with it. We have no choice. We
what?
Can't lock ourselves up in a basement
what?
Like Joe does. He has the he has the ability to lock himself up. I don't know. He's obviously made a lot of money someplace.
Oh, my God.
But he has this thing about living in a basement. People can't do that.
You know, Joe Biden hasn't been in his basement in a couple of months now. He's been out on the campaign trail. This is what Donald Trump does. It's like what he does with Anthony Fauci. Because at the beginning, he said, no, don't wear masks. because there was such a shortage of PPE. They were worried that people would take masks that medical professionals so desperately needed. And then, as scientists do with more research, they change their prescriptions. They change their recommendations. But Donald Trump, oh no, he told you not to wear a mask. Get over it already. And so the basement thing, get over it already. So anyway, you heard what he said, though. He said, we're learning to live with it.
Your reaction?
I say over soon. I say we're learning to live with it. We have...
Oh, my God. Learning to live with it? What do you say to that, Joe Biden?
He says that we're learning to live with it. People are learning to die with it.
Uh-huh.
You folks home will have an empty chair at the kitchen table this morning. That man or wife going to bed tonight and reaching over to try to touch their, out of habit, where their wife or husband was, is gone. Learning to live with it. Come on. We're dying with it.
Yeah.
Because he has never said, you said it's dangerous. When's the last time? Is it really dangerous still? Are we dangerous? You tell the people it's dangerous now.
No, he
what
won't.
Should they do about the danger? And you say, I take no responsibility.
He did. He said it at least twice. I have it in my archives. But of course, Donald Trump lies. So what did he say last night? I never said that. But listen to... This was one of my favorite clips of the night. Listen carefully to Donald Trump's words. He says, I take full responsibility. And immediately afterwards, he says, it's not my fault.
Let me talk about your two...
Excuse me, I take full responsibility. It's not my fault that he came here. It's China's fault.
It's China's fault. It's China's fault. I take full responsibility, but it's not my fault. It's their fault. He's fucking nuts. Thankfully, Kristen Welker asked about the news story that broke just the other day that the United States can't locate the parents of more than 500 children we separated from their parents at the border. So she asked, the question was, how will these children ever be reconciled? And hold on, I got to find my, I lost my numbers here. Wait a second, 15 and 16, where are you? Okay, so the question was, you got to remember what the question was because he never answered the questions. how will these families ever be reunited was the question. Here's Donald Trump's answer.
President, your administration separated children from their parents at the border, at least 4,000 kids. You've since reversed your zero tolerance policy, but the United States can't locate the parents of more than 500 children. So how will these families ever be reunited?
Children are brought here by coyotes and lots of bad people.
No.
Cartels.
Not in this case.
And they're brought here, and they used to use them to get into our country. We now have as strong a border as we've ever had.
Aye.
We're over 400 miles of brand new wall. You see the numbers. And we let people in, but they have to come in legally, and they come in through
America. But how will you reunite these kids with their families, Mr. President?
Let me just tell you. They built cages. You know, they used to say, I built the cages. And then they had a picture in a certain newspaper. And it was a picture of these horrible cages. And they said, look at these cages. President Trump built them.
Horrible.
And then it was determined they were built
by the Obama administration.
That was him.
Do you have a plan to reunite the kids?
Yes, do you have a plan?
We're trying very hard. But a lot of these kids come out without the parents. They come over through cartels and through coyotes and through gangs.
Vice President Biden.
Okay. First of all, the Obama administration did build those cages. Big cages. But they didn't take babies away from their mothers. Nursing babies were taken from the mother's breast. Taken from them. The Obama administration didn't do that. They're not blameless. Yes, they built those cages. The Trump administration took children away from their parents and put them in there. What did Joe Biden have to say to this question?
These 500 plus kids came with parents. They separated them at the border to make it a disincentive to come to begin with. Bay, real tough. We're really strong. And guess what? They cannot, it's not coyotes didn't bring them over. Their parents were with them. They got separated from their parents.
Hello.
And it makes us a laughing stock and violates every notion of who we are as a nation.
Yes, it does.
Let me ask
you a question. Wait, listen to this.
Did it. We changed the policy.
They built the cages.
Who built the cages,
Let's talk about what we're talking about. What happened? Parents were ripped, their kids were ripped from their arms and separated. And now they cannot find over 500 of sets of those parents, and those kids are alone. Nowhere to go. Nowhere to go. It's criminal.
Yep.
It's criminal.
Let me ask you about
immigration.
Kristen,
I will say this. They went down. We brought reporters, everything. They are so well taken care of. They're in facilities that were so clean.
But some of them haven't been reunited.
But just ask one question.
Oh, my God.
Who built the cages?
I don't care. Who built the cages?
Let me ask about
your immigration. Did you hear what he said there? They're so well taken care of. He actually said that.
It's criminal.
Let me ask you about
immigration.
Kristen,
I will say this. They went down. We brought reporters, everything. They are so well taken care of.
Oh, my God. That might have been the most shocking moment of the debate. By the way, he talked about we brought reporters down there to see them. These children that were so well taken care of. Well, one of those journalists is Jacob Soboroff, who was on MSNBC last night after the debate. And he checked in. He said, that's not the case. Quote, what I saw there were little children sitting on concrete floors covered by Mylar blankets, supervised by security contractors in a watchtower. It makes me sick every time I recall it. But this is Donald Trump, who lies every time he opens his mouth. Then, you know, he brought out one of his greatest hits.
Nobody has done more for the black community than Donald Trump. And if you look, with the exception of Abraham Lincoln,
possibly,
of Abraham Lincoln, nobody has done what I've done.
Yeah. Are you kidding me? And the look on Joe Biden's face when he said the Abraham Lincoln thing was pretty priceless, right? Joe Biden fought back.
Marauding gangs, young gangs, and the people who are going to maraud our cities. This is a guy who, in the Central Park Five innocent black kids, he continued to push for making sure that they got the death penalty. None of them were guilty of the crimes they were suggested. Look, and talk about he did in fact let 20 people. He commuted 20 people's sentences. We commuted over 1,000 people's sentences. Over 1,000. The very law he's talking about is a law that, in fact, initiated by Barack Obama. And secondly, we're in a situation here where the federal prison system was reduced by 38,000 people under our administration. And one of the things we should be doing, there should be no minimum mandatories in the law.
Mandatory
That's why
minimums,
I'm offering $20 billion to states to change their state laws to eliminate minimum mandatories and set up drug courts. No one should be going to jail because they have a drug problem. They should be going to rehabilitation, not to jail.
Well, that's true. Joe Biden hit him on one other point, and Donald Trump just shows he just doesn't have a sense of humor, because Biden hit back here.
President Biden, Abraham, let me ask you very quickly, and then I have a follow-up question for you.
Abraham Lincoln here is one of the most racist presidents we've had in modern history. He pours fuel on every single racist fire. Every single one. Started off his campaign coming down the escalator saying he's going to get rid of those Mexican rapists. He's banned Muslims because they're Muslims. He has moved around and made everything worse across the board. He says about the poor boys. Last time we were on stage here, he said, I told him to stand down and stand ready. Come on. This guy is a dog whistle about as big as a foghorn.
President Trump, I'm going to give you 10 seconds to respond, and then I have a follow-up.
You made a reference to Abraham Lincoln. Where did that come in?
I mean, you said you're Abraham Lincoln.
No.
I said
not since Abraham Lincoln anybody done what I've done for the black community.
And I'm saying,
I didn't say I'm Abraham Lincoln. I said not since Abraham Lincoln has anybody done what I've done for the black
community. Right. And that's what he chooses to double down on? Oh, please. Yeah. You know, again, we can go back to Joe Biden and
come on, man.
All right, we're gonna switch gears a little bit here, but there is a segue. I'm very excited about our guest today. Nicholas Kristof is a 2-time Pulitzer Prize winning columnist for the New York Times. The occasion of his appearance is the release of the film Tightrope: Americans Reaching for Hope. It goes along with the companion book that came out last year. The film has its national TV debut this coming Monday, 7 p.m. Eastern on the World Channel and online at worldchannel.org and pbs.org. And again, it's the companion to the book of the same name released earlier this year, a project he was joined on by his wife, Cheryl Wudun, a collaborator on a number of projects. They share a Pulitzer Prize for their coverage of China. And Nick Kristof, welcome to the program, and thank you so much for joining us today.
Delighted to be with you.
So, you know, I watched the film with just an aching in my heart because you spotlight the heart of what's wrong in this country. And I'm watching the debate last night, and I can't help but thinking that you did the research for this project before the pandemic hit. So as bad as things were, and we'll explain, you know, what is bad, they're only going to keep getting worse. Donald Trump brags of, we had the best economy, I built the best economy in the history of the country, which wasn't true. And we'll get into that too, because the book is about hope, or the lack of hope. The subtitle is Americans Reaching for Hope. Tell us the premise of it. What made you do this research?
With the issues that we talk about that, you know, that got worse, one of the issues we write about is the toll of unemployment. That's obviously gotten worse. We talk about the toll of social isolation and addiction. That's obviously gotten worse. The toll of a lack of universal health care. And obviously, you know, that is worse above all during a pandemic. But essentially what Tightrope was about was the disintegration of the working class in America. And we told it through my hometown, Yamhill, Oregon, small farm town. And in particular, we told it through the people on my old school bus, who I'm still close to. But a quarter of them are now dead from drugs, alcohol, and suicide, what are called deaths of despair. And, you know, if you want to understand what has gone wrong in an awful lot of America, you could look at my classmates on that school bus and their families.
The school bus number 6. And so you've kept in touch with these people because your mother still lives in the house you grew up in, right? Or did?
That's right. She's still on the family farm. I go back all the time. And, you know, when they're kids you grow up with, you flirted with, you went out with, you competed with on the track, there's, you know, nothing can create distance between you.
And then you realized, and now all these years have passed, we're about the same age, so all these years have passed, and you realize that a good number of the kids you grew up with are not only not doing well, they're not doing at all. A lot of them are no longer with us. And this is a byproduct of the poverty, the drug problems, the homelessness, the lack of hope in America.
Yeah, the family that got on the bus right after I did each morning, it was the 5 Knapp kids. Farlan was my grade, his younger brother Zeelan, younger brother Keelan, younger brother Nathan, and younger sister Regina, all 5 happy kids. Their dad was a pipe layer who had turned a good union blue-collar job into a middle-class life. And Farlan lost his job and died of liver failure from drug and alcohol use. Nathan blew himself up cooking meth. Zeelan died in a house fire when he was passed out drunk. Regina died of hepatitis from injecting drugs. And Keelan died just in March from a heroin overdose after he'd lost his job because of COVID.
Wow.
And it's just one kid after another, and that has just happened, I mean, not maybe to that degree, but that kind of tragedy has unfolded in so much of American communities, white and black and brown, all across the country. And, you know, we have the tools to address that. We have the resources. What we've lacked is the political will.
You use your hometown of Yamhill, Oregon, as the jumping off point, but then you took your research on the road and realized this is just one of thousands of small towns across America where the same issues are plaguing people. Now let's back up a little bit, Nick, because again, when you wrote the book, the original book, Threshold, and did the research, and I went and shot footage and everything, it was before COVID had hit. It was when Donald Trump was bragging that he built the best economy in the history of the world. He didn't, though. And although the stock market may have been riding high, most Americans, especially the Americans you're talking about in this book and in this film, don't have money in the stock market. I don't have money in the stock market. I'm an average American who's been struggling actually since the 2008 crash. This has only made it worse. Talk about that disconnect where the president of the United States boasts about the greatest economy the world has ever seen, but most of America is struggling and dying like this.
There's a huge disconnect, and in many ways, President Trump is emblematic of it. But frankly, it has also affected, you know, Democrats as well as Republicans. A lot of elites, educated elites in this country, have done very well. And if you were highly educated in America, the odds are that you've done pretty well. But meanwhile, if you only have a high school degree, or even worse, if you haven't graduated from high school, as one in seven Americans still do, you're cooked. You know, the average non-supervisory wage in 2018 was lower, adjusted for inflation, than it had been in 1973.
Wow.
Just think about that. Lower in 2018 than in 1973. The 1968 federal minimum wage, if it had kept pace with inflation and productivity, would now be more than $22 an hour.
Yeah.
Obviously, it's, you know, instead it's $7.25.
That's right.
And so, you know, so many Americans have floundered as they've struggled in the job market. And, you know, some of them, we have this narrative about how it's all about personal responsibility and bad choices. And, you know, there's no doubt that there are plenty of kids I grew up with who made some bad choices and in some cases showed a lack of personal responsibility. But they made those bad choices out of a context. And, you know, a baby in three counties in the U.S. has a shorter life expectancy than a newborn baby in Cambodia or Bangladesh. And that's not because those babies are making bad choices. It's because we as a society are making bad choices.
You know, earlier in the program, as I was telling listeners, you were joining us, and I mentioned that it's just, again, the disconnect here. I totally lost my train of thought here. That it happens, but again with the stock market and all that, we're told one thing, but something else is going on with COVID right now. We are on the verge of an even bigger disaster. All the things that you talk about in this film are still there. That's reality in small town America everywhere. But things are about to get a whole lot worse, right? Because I live in Florida, for example. My governor, who I've nicknamed Ron Death Sentence, just lifted the moratorium on evictions. So all these people who are now unemployed, can't pay their rent, can't pay their mortgage. Now, they're maybe a couple of months behind. He lifted the moratorium on evictions right before the 1st of October. So we're going to see, I mean, homelessness explode across the country. This is the other thing that I was thinking about, is that during the campaign, we heard so much talk about the middle class jobs, middle class. We rarely hear our candidates talk about those people living in poverty. And I believe that's the largest, fastest growing segment of our society.
Yeah, there's a lot of conversation about the work, about the middle class, almost not about the working class. And, you know, there was a really healthy, important discussion in the Democratic primaries about improving college access and dealing with college debt. And that's an important discussion to have. But unless we come to grips with the fact that one in seven American kids still doesn't graduate from high school, then we can't grapple with this kind of inequity in the U.S. You know, in Native American schools, the graduation rate for Bureau of Indian Education schools is only 53%.
Wow.
Almost half of Native kids in these government schools don't even graduate from high school. So we've got to have, that conversation. And, you know, and social, I think we also don't understand the toll of loneliness and social isolation in much of the country.
And there's that's exploding now, too.
Absolutely. You know, a quarter of young people said in a survey in June that they were considering suicide.
Yeah.
13% of Americans said that they had engaged in substance abuse or had increased their substance abuse because of COVID-19. And because kids have not been going to school so much, we often don't have the surveillance network mechanism to detect things like abuse at home.
Right.
But that is surely going on a massive scale right now.
Well, and apparently domestic abuse instances are up as well because people are stuck at home. I'm very lucky. I've got a wonderful husband. We're both older. I mean, you know, it's my birthday, November 4th. I'm just so excited for my birthday week. But, you know, at 61 and 68, we're in that high-risk category, and, you know, I'm a lung cancer survivor, so lungs get hit. So I don't leave the house. Luckily, I've got a loving husband, but my daughter turned 21 during our isolation time. Here at home, she left her job. I finally convinced her to take a job she was offered because I didn't think it was healthy for her to be stuck in the house with her parents for months on end, and who knows when this is going to end. Now, she's being careful and wearing a mask, but, you know, she's around people every day. It's a risk. But there are all those people who are in my position but who don't have the loving husband, who are stuck at home, who are afraid to go out, who shouldn't go out, and loneliness sets in addition to the poverty and the hunger and the other issues, this is going to just explode. And we have a president in the White House who's in denial about all of it.
That's right. And, you know, we've often discussed COVID in the context of the immediate health effects. I don't think we've had enough discussion about the job effects. And one of the reasons we wrote Tightrope and did the documentary was really because of our sense that too often in the country, we've thought of jobs as an income stream. And there is now so much evidence that they are beyond that, a source of identity, a source of purpose, of meaning.
Right. Social life too, in many cases. Social life too, in many cases.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And they knit people into a community. And, you know, now, you know, then 11 million people lost their jobs since February. 11 million. And we can't even come up with a bipartisan rescue package to support them since the end of July. European countries did a very good job in basically paying employers to keep people on the job. And that meant that unemployment didn't go sky high and people didn't self-medicate. And of course, in countries outside the U.S., even if they do lose their job, they don't lose their health insurance as they do in the U.S.
Right.
In the U.S., you know, a million people, because they lost their jobs, also lost their health insurance in the middle of a plague.
And the Democrats floated the idea of having an open enrollment period for the Affordable Care Act for all those people who lost their health coverage with their jobs. And the Trump administration said no. And not only that, they're still going to court on November 11th to the Supreme Court to overturn what's left of it to take it away from the rest of us. Again, I mentioned to you, I'm a lung cancer survivor. Hello, I'm self-employed. I work out of my home studio. I do this radio show. Without the Affordable Care Act, I don't have insurance. I don't have health insurance. I'm wondering, Nick Kristof is with us. We're talking about the new film that'll be premiering on Monday night streaming on PBS.org and at worldchannel.org and airing on the World Channel, if you have it, at 7 p.m. Eastern. When you went back to Yamhill and you met with some of your old friends and kids that you rode the school bus with, there was one man, I recall you sitting in his home. He was a very heavy set man who took care of your mother, expressed great love for her, for your family.
Yeah.
And I realized this man has health problems. How much of the poverty do you think comes from health issues, from lack of insurance or lack of a job to pay for insurance and mounting medical bills?
You know, these issues are all integrated. So you're talking about my friend Clayton.
Yeah.
He was one of five kids, and four of them are now gone, including Clayton. Clayton died just as we were finishing the documentary. And, you know, Clayton, it's all integrated. So Clayton was kicked out of school in the ninth grade. He then could not get the kind of good union job that his dad had had as a cement finisher. Clayton self-medicated. He's a very bright guy, but he self-medicated with drugs and alcohol out of frustration, I think. He couldn't, he wasn't able to form a stable family the way his dad had. And I think that that gnawed at him and that ate at him. And he was indeed very overweight. He was 400 pounds.
Oh, my.
But that was in turn a reflection of his job difficulties, of his poverty, of his lack of educational attainment. And we as a society spent money prosecuting and incarcerating Clayton, but not educating him and not providing job retraining or drug treatment. And Clayton is now gone, but he's got five grandkids that have all been removed by the state. All removed by the state. And, you know, I just see these problems transmitted from generation to generation in ways that I just find heartbreaking.
When you go back there, and again, your mother still lives there, so obviously you go there. Is there ever any resentment? I mean, look, you went off to the big city. You're a New York Times columnist, Pulitzer Prize winning journalist. Is there any, you know, does anybody show a problem with your success that they're not having, that they're stuck there and unable to break out of this rut?
I don't think so. If they do, it's behind my back. Okay, I think they're genuinely proud of the things I've done. I was a little apprehensive after the book came out, and now with the documentary coming out, whether people back home will think that I'm, you know, airing dirty laundry. It's, you know, we're pretty blunt about some of the problems. But my sense is that people there, you know, they know better than anybody the local problems.
Right.
And they tend to be conservative. They tend to be Trump voters. They don't agree with my interpretation of it. But they don't want your sympathy. They don't even want your agreement. What they want is respect. What they want to be is listened to. And I think that they're going to think that the documentary listens to them and treats them with respect.
Good, because it's shining a spotlight on an urgent issue and one that, as we said, doesn't get talked about enough. But what you said really bothers me. I mean, I get they're conservative, but Trump supporters, I see so many people living in poverty voting against their own best interests. This man does not care about them, and I don't know what it would take to make them see it. I mean, you saw Joe Biden in the debate last night saying, look, nobody should go to jail because of a drug conviction. They should go to treatment. We need to fix this. Donald Trump says, you know, Central Park Five, even though they weren't guilty, we should put him to death anyway. You know, again, I keep going back to disconnect. Then there's the state. This is the richest nation on the planet. You've got all these oil-rich countries. We have more money than they do, yet one in five children in the United States goes to bed hungry at night. There's something really wrong there.
You know, people often ask me how it is that my old classmates so often voted for Trump. How is it that people who are really struggling can vote for a New York zillionaire who exploits them? I think that part of it is that they were extraordinarily desperate and they saw their lives and community disintegrating. I think, and then, you know, along comes this guy who promises that he's going to bring back manufacturing jobs. He points to scapegoats of immigrants and says he can fix the problem. And when you're, you know, one of the people we wrote about was my old seventh grade crush, Mary Mayer. And she spent 7 years homeless. Four members of her family committed suicide. At one point, she put a gun to her head. And I'd asked her once, did you ever think that politics might help address these problems? And she said, no, not until 2016, and then she voted for the first time in her life for Donald Trump.
Oh my God.
And I was just like, Mary.
Oh my God.
But, you know, I'd say that I think there's often a misperception that the white working class is simply conservative, and it's more complicated than that. They tend to be socially conservative, but economically more liberal. And historically, they've gone into the polling booth, and you know, if the issues has been guns or gay rights or abortion, then they're more likely to vote for Republicans. But if the issue is raising the minimum wage, if it's expanding access to health care, providing child care, then they're much more likely to vote Democratic.
Mm-hmm.
And it may well be that in this economic crisis that has so made clear our national failings, you know, it may be that this is a time when more of them will vote Democratic.
Do you know if the message is getting through to them, the fact that a handful of billionaires have made out like bandits through this pandemic when the rest of us are going broke and blowing through our savings, if we were lucky enough to have any, that the billionaires have increased their wealth exponentially because, you know, they had essential businesses, I guess. They're the ones capitalizing on this. Jeff Bezos is, I don't know how many billions of dollars richer, and he still doesn't pay taxes. Do they get that? They don't get it.
It's striking to me how my friends, you know, so many of them live in a conservative ecosystem, mostly on Facebook, in which their news consumption is completely different from mine, and their understanding of the world is completely different from mine. And I think that and Fox News has tended to, you know, reinforce their pre-existing ideas and beliefs, and also a sense that they are looked down upon and scorned by Democratic elites on the coasts, that Democrats, you know, want to violate their freedom of religion, want to take their guns away, et cetera, et cetera, and play upon these kind of cultural fears in ways that, unfortunately, I think are often effective.
Yes. And you mentioned Fox, and we've got to go there. I mean, I have a radio sounder, Fox News, we make shit up. They are the original source for fake news. It says that too. They were doing fake news long before Donald Trump tried to do the opposite world thing on us and call real news fake news and project his nonsense onto everybody else. And because Fox is so pervasive, again, people are brainwashed by it. And I really think that's what happened to Donald Trump, too. He used to be a Manhattan quasi-liberal. I mean, who knows what he was? He was always kind of ignorant of what's going on in the real world. But he was pro-choice. He donated money to Democrats. And all of a sudden, he's this crazy white right-wing conspiracy theorist. And I believe it's because he's addicted to Fox.
I'd push back on that. I don't think he really believes any of this stuff. I think he's just an opportunist.
Okay.
I think he just says things if he thinks there's an advantage, and he thought that he could gain the Republican nomination, and to do that he had to be pro-life rather than pro-choice. I don't think he
has really any convictions at all.
Believes anything at all.
Yeah, you know what? I'm with you there. I'm with you there. I mean, we've heard from some of these books that have come out of the things he says about these people, his constituents.
Right.
He's glad about the COVID so he doesn't have to shake the hands of those gross people. About the evangelicals who laid their hands on him in the office. Apparently, he had some choice words to say about them as well. And yet they keep drinking the Kool-Aid. That's what I don't understand. I don't know when common sense takes over, just like the disconnect between the United States being the richest nation in the history of the world, and there's so much poverty here. And maybe it's, Nicholas Kristof, you and your wife, I'm so glad you did this book and this film, Tightrope, because it is shining a spotlight on the thing that, you know, you only talk about quietly. You don't say it out loud. Well, we need to say it out loud.
You know, I think that's right. And I think there's this misperception in the U.S. that this kind of poverty and job losses is all a result of globalization and technology and deindustrialization. And, you know,
that's
these are genuine issues.
Yeah.
But fundamentally, the same global patterns happen to Germany, they happen to Canada, and we don't see that kind of child poverty in those countries. We have kids who are poor, who are hungry in this country. Kids are 55% more likely to die in the U.S. than in Europe by age 19 because of choices that we as a country made. And it's not because of lack of personal responsibility of those kids. It's because of lack of collective responsibility on our part. And that's why we wrote Tightrope.
Tightrope. Tightrope, Americans reaching for hope. is there a hopeful note in there that you can share with us? Because I'm feeling pretty hopeless right now.
Oh, let me try to reassure you.
Please.
I actually am a little more hopeful now than I was a few months ago, because I think that COVID-19 has been such a catastrophe that it has reminded people about the need for universal health care, for universal paid sick leave, for really fundamental changes. Only about 30% of Americans say that the country is on the right path now. And you know, think about the 1932 election. It was precisely because the Great Depression had been so disastrous, and because Herbert Hoover's administration had been so calamitous and incapable of addressing it, that FDR was able to win a mandate to flip the Senate in the 1932 election and then launch the New Deal. And, you know, FDR was not a revolutionary any more than Joe Biden was, but they saw that. And they had popular desire to really begin to address fundamental problems. I think that we now actually have more of a chance to address those fundamental issues than we might have a year ago if there had been no pandemic.
Oh, that's interesting. Okay. And Joe Biden has also hinted at, you know, that he could have an FDR type of presidency. The skeptic in me says, but the hopefulness in me says, please, is it in there? Yeah. But, you know, then I hear him say, I'm not for Medicare for all, and I'm not for ending fracking. And it's like, okay, I bite my tongue.
You know, look at the polling. And so some kind of a public option to expand health coverage has majority public support in America at this point. Some kind of a universal child care slash national pre-K has majority support in America. Bandwidth for All has majority support. A wealth tax has majority support. So, you know, the public is actually rather more progressive than, you know, than the consensus among our leaders. And I'm hoping that there is so much desperation and difficulty that that may indeed drive our country belatedly to try to fix some of these long-term problems in America.
I certainly hope so. I keep telling my listeners I want a really good birthday present this year. Again, we end voting on November 3rd. I would love to wake up on November 4th and celebrate. A lot of us are gun shy after 2016 and after 2000. I'm here in Florida, so there's a lot of anxiety happening right now, and hopefully that will go away as things hopefully start getting better. Using the
I'm
word
reasonably hope a lot. Confident.
I'm from your words to reality, please. Nicholas Kristof, what a pleasure it is to talk to you. I've been a fan of yours for years. I really appreciate your time, and I'm so glad you made this movie and the book, Tightrope, Americans Reaching for Hope. Again, the film has its national television debut Monday night at 7 on the World Channel. It'll also be online at worldchannel.org and pbs.org. Nick, thank you so much.
And great to talk to you.
Great to talk to you, too. Thank you. Bye-bye. And wow, what a treat that was. I hope he's right. We need change. And we need to not keep these people invisible. So many people in this country are suffering. I'm glad there's finally a spotlight being shown on the poverty in this country. I've heard candidates for decades talking about the middle class and the working class, and you never hear them talk about those people living in poverty. Well, those numbers are growing, and they're only going to get worse over the next short period of time until this pandemic is under control. There is so much at stake. And Monday, Mitch McConnell is going to try to push through Amy Coney Barrett, and I don't think there's anything we can do about it. So we've got a challenge ahead of us. And I guess it's, you know, our lot in life to take it on. But don't ignore those invisible people. They're not invisible. They're holding on for dear life with everything that's in them. Tightrope, Americans Reaching for Hope. I'll put a link to where you can watch it on the blog at NicoleSandler.com today. Thanks for being here this week. We'll be back Monday. Stay sane, everyone, and stay safe. Thanks for listening. Have a great weekend. Bye.